Well, top of the morning to you, YouTube. It's a beautiful winter morning here in West Virginia. The sun's not out. It's cold. It's damp. It's wet. Such is life. Okay, I've had several people ask when we're talking about milling and doing some milling stuff, and I mentioned the term board foot. Several people have asked, Troy, what exactly is a board foot and why is it so important to discuss when it comes to milling? So let's get into that. Well, a board foot is actually a measurement of volume. And that may seem kind of odd to say, well, why are you measuring volume when we're talking about linear boards? Well, actually, a board foot is a measurement of a board that is 1 inch thick or 4/4 thick. We'll get into that in a second. That 12 inches wide and 12 inches long. So you imagine a tile or a flat piece of wood that's a 12 inch by 12 inch square, 1 inch thick. That is a board foot. So it seems pretty simple, but when you go to calculate it for non-typical boards, then that's where it can kind of get a little tricky. So the obvious question is, how do you measure board feet when your board isn't 12 inches wide or 12 inches long? Well, there's actually a pretty simple formula you use. It is a basic volume formula. You take the thickness in inches, the width in inches, and the length in inches. You got to make sure you convert it to inches. You multiply all those together. And then you divide it by 144, and that gets you your board footage. So for example, this board laying right here is, we're going to say it's 1 inch thick. Yeah, pretty much. 4/4, we'll say. And it's 7 inches wide, and it is 10.5 feet long. So I've put that in my formula. That's 1 times 7 times 120 plus the half, 126, right? So 1 times 7 times 126 divided by 144 equals this. So that's the true calculation of the board footage of this one board. So this equation works for no matter what your thicknesses are, or any dimension for that matter. If this board was 15 inches wide and 2 inches thick and 10 feet long, or only 2 feet long and so many inches wide, the formula always works, and it always calculates the total number of board feet found in one piece of wood or one board. So let's look at this whole stack here. So in this stack of pine lumber that I milled a while back, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39. That 38th one probably I shouldn't count because he's the last cutoff. So let's say 38 for example. We'll discount that. So 38 boards. I know they're all 7 inches wide, and they vary, 10 feet to maybe 11 feet. So we're going to say 10 feet just for the sake of rounding down. So let's do our math now. So that's 1 for the thickness, 7 inches for the width, 120 inches for the length. Multiply all that together, divide by 144 equals this. Then when we multiply that by 38, that's our total number of board feet that we have in this stack of lumber. Now again, that's an estimate. I talked about the variations in length, and we've got Wayne here. So if I was truly trying to grade this, that's a whole nother video discussion, getting into grading, talking about Wayne, quality of wood, blah, blah, blah. But that's roughly how many board feet I have standing here in this stack. So why is this so important in sawing or hardwoods or rough cut lumber? You think when you go to the box store, you say, I want X amount of 2x4s, so many feet long, and you're not even dealing in board feet. So why is it unique to this? Well, just because of that simple point. When you go to a box store and you buy softwood dimensional lumber, it's already dimensionalized, completely. You know exactly what you're getting there. With hardwoods or rough sawn, there can be a lot of variation. So it's key in calculating cost or total amount of wood that you're going to get. Now, it's not the only thing you worry about, but it is usually the starting point, and that's what's used to set pricing. So let's take this stack of wood, the purpose of the stack of wood, as an example again. This is siding to finish out the last corner of our farrowing barn, and it's stuff that obviously we milled here. If I was going to a sawyer and saying, hey, I need some boards to finish up the siding on my barn, the first thing he's going to do is price it based upon board footage, not necessarily the number of boards I need, nor the length or the thickness. Now, obviously, that conversation will be had. I don't want him giving me a whole bunch of little thin strips, nor do I want stuff that's, you know, 18 inches wide or 6 foot long versus what I need 10 foot long. So that sawyer would take my other dimensions into consideration, but when it came time to actually calculating my bill, he should, most likely, calculate all the board feet and say, okay, this is what I charge per board foot for Virginia pine that's not dried, that's within this length or within this width. I charge, you know, $1 a board foot or $2 a board foot, whatever he's charging at that time. So that's where we do the calculation and figure out our cost. Now, board footage is actually used further upstream in the milling process because you know, a good forester, a good timber assessment guy, can look at a log like this red oak and can roughly calculate the amount of board feet in it. Again, taking diameter measurements, doing all that type of stuff, that's a whole nother video. But it could look at a log and say, we think there's about X amount of board feet in this log. And so if this log is transacted, if somebody's buying this log to turn it into lumber, then that's factored into that. Now, it's one of the factors. Again, grade and all that type of stuff are just as important. But a calculation of board feet would most likely be passed around when talking about this specific log. Granted, usually done in the larger scale of a whole bunch of logs. But let's take red oak for example. So back in the heyday of woodworking, I don't do as much woodworking as I used to, but back when I was really producing a lot of furniture and components for resale, red oak was my number one used wood. I couldn't mill red oak enough, fast enough with our old mill and the things we had, and of course, wait for it to air dry. I had too many projects going on. So I would go to a local mill and buy red oak boards in quantities of 500 board feet at a time. So it was literally a bundle. I wouldn't get the high-end grade, or the what was called the firsts, simply because I couldn't afford it at the time. I needed the volume, and I didn't mind with my planer and cutting around knots, I didn't mind taking that on. But again, whole different story there. But when I would roll up there, and I would pay, I think I was paying $2.50 a board foot for kiln-dried four-quarter red oak, and lengths varied. They weren't over 12 feet long, but they weren't under 6 feet long. And the widths varied as well. So I didn't know what I was getting when it came to length and width. I did know I was getting 4/4. I did know I was getting kiln dried down to 8%. And I did know I was getting 500 board feet. So I would roll up, they'd load me up. We calculated all based on board feet. And then I would just obviously come back to the wood shop. So what if you're the sawyer and you want to try to figure out how to price lumber coming off your mill? Well, again, use board feet because that's what most people are going to expect. You don't have to, but that's the norm. That's where people are going to start. But you're going to price your board feet. It shouldn't be the same for every single piece of wood that comes off of your mill. There's a lot of variation that should change that cost per board foot, but the board foot should be that constant. So for example, your per board foot price could vary by length. So if somebody wants excessively long boards, like maybe a 14 foot or a 16 foot, if that's what your mill can handle, then of course that should have more value than a bunch of 4 foot boards or a bunch of 6 foot boards. Same with all dimensions. The width, if somebody wants really wide, clean red oak and you want 12 inch or 14 inch, okay, that's a pretty tall order. There's not a lot of logs laying around that can produce that. So that's going to have to have a premium too. So that per board foot price should be higher. Same with thickness. If somebody, especially if you're drying, if somebody wants, you know, 8/4 or they want 12/4 thick kiln dried red oak, then that should have a much higher per board foot price. Now, obviously species goes into play there. So, you know, looking at a pine or a poplar versus a walnut, which is, you know, one of the higher priced domestic woods around here. Yeah, that's going to change dramatically. It should change like multiple 100% there when it comes to board foot pricing. Think about the drying. You know, if you're setting up your mill and you're going to put in a kiln and you're going to go that far, then obviously kiln dried wood should raise the price of the board footage versus air dried or just green wood. And then of course grading. If you really want to get fancy, actually grading. And I don't recommend anybody trying to take on grading if they haven't been professionally trained on how to grade wood. I've been milling for, you know, 20 years off and on, and I don't even begin to try to grade stuff. That's I would say it's difficult. It's not difficult. You just have to know what it means, and you have to go to the class. You have to learn from somebody, and you have to do it a lot. You have to have that experience to be good at grading, because you know, if you're try to grade stuff and somebody says, well, that's not right. That's not a first select. That's a second. And then you get in that argument. It just doesn't work. So, you know, go to a class, read a book, do all that type of stuff and get experience or learn under somebody else if you're going into grading. That's a whole nother video. Okay, so earlier in the video, I mentioned the importance of using the quartering system for thicknesses versus just getting an inch measurement. And again, you stick with standards. If I actually measured this board is about, it's a cat's whisker over 7/8 of an inch thick. So it's not exactly a 1 inch, but it would still fall into the 4/4 category. It's actually air dried here a bit when it was green. It was a true 4/4. But if you look, so here's this board here that's a thinner thickness, smaller thickness. It's probably only a 1/2 inch, and then or what we'd call a 2/4. And then this one would be a 4/4. Thickness does come into play there, and you want to use that quartering system because it's going to not only help be consistent with your potential buyers or potential sellers, but it's also going to be easier in calculating. It's going to keep you from losing your rear end too at times. So take, for example, let's say this board is actually a 5/4. So that would be around 1.25 inches, 1 1/4 inches. So let's do an example here. Let's say instead of this stack of 38, we have a stack of 15 boards that are actually 5/4 thick, and they are 8 inches wide by 12 feet long. I just picked those numbers arbitrarily just so I can do the math. So 5/4 thick, 8 inches wide, 12 feet long, and we've got 15 of them. So let's say you're like, well, 5/4, I think it's 5/4, or I don't remember what I milled, but I'm going to sell this as 4/4, and you do all the calculations off that. That math, if you plug that math in, would come to 120 board feet. But if this is truly a 5/4, so it's just 1/4 inch thicker on those 8 boards, you can see how exponentially that plays out. So you do the math on a 5/4 board, and that comes to 150 feet. So there's 30 board feet that were lost there. So if this was cherry instead of pine, and you were selling this at $4 a board foot, air dried, then you could see $30, that's a $120 swing there you just lost. So it's really critical to use those quarter systems to keep you from being out of whack. Now, on the flip side, don't use the inch system and say, okay, this is 1.08 inches thick. So that's what I'm gonna calculate when I sell this wood to somebody. That's what I'm gonna calculate the board footage as. Yeah, that's not very appropriate either. So I actually knew a guy that had a portable mill, and he would take his mill all over to different farms, and he'd mill for people that would bring their, drag their log down to a spot. He'd park his mill. They'd stage them there, and they would mill. And he'd stay there until the job was done. Well, he'd calculate his cost, setup fee, transport fee. But then his largest cost was his board footage fee. So whatever amount of board feet that he created was what he charged by. Well, for the sake of ease, instead of coming back and adding up all these stacks of wood, he would actually, when he would square the log, when he would make the cant, the square log, he would take a quick measurement of that and just jot it down before he started taking his passes. So he was actually charging the customer board footage price on the square log. Now, technically, that is accurate, except for the smoking gun in that, and I know most of you guys are picked up on it already, the smoking gun in that is the thickness of the kerf coming through and cutting that cant into actual lumber. So if he was doing a bunch of 4/4 stuff, so for every 4/4 board, if he has a bandsaw blade with an 1/8 inch kerf, every 9 boards, he's losing an inch in material there. So he's kind of cheating somebody out of a whole board every 9 boards in that sense. Now, granted, that's, that could be something that could be agreed upon at the beginning. He may have had that conversation with the customer in advance to say, hey, I charge by the cant board footage, not by the finished product. And again, if that's been discussed, that's fine. But there can be some smoke and mirrors when it comes to calculating that. So it's good to know the system. And if you're going to go buy wood, take a tape measure with you and just double check that. I know a lot of homesteaders want to build barns. They want to put that kind of stuff together. So if you're going to a mill and you're buying board footage, just make sure you fully understand what it's all about and man, you may tick somebody off or you may get a grumble, but take a tape measure out and measure that just to make sure you're getting what you ask for. You know, wood gets expensive. Well, I hope this discussion of board foot helps out some of the homesteaders. I know a lot of you guys probably know this. Some of you guys have a way more sawing experience than I do, but point out some other details about board footage I may have missed. That's just off the top of my head and what I've put together. So comment and let's keep the conversation going. All right, take care, everybody.